Hello everyone. In this short presentation, I consider three notions: joint action, collective improvisation, and orientation. As you can see from the title, I seek to convey the theoretical interest of providing a common analysis of both. In outlining this analysis, I will shortly refer to some relevant theoretical positions nowadays endorsed in the debate related to these three notions. So let's start with the first couple: improvisation and orientation, a plausible connection and five common symptoms. First thesis, the notion of orientation and improvisation, although intuitively distinct, on more careful consideration seem to show a significant connection. General plausibility of this thesis, we improvise when we are disoriented, and conversely, in order to successfully improvise, we need somehow to gain a new orientation. Five common symptoms of orientation and improvisational skills. Here I refer to the analysis of orientation formulated by Werner Stegmeier in his recent monography on this subject. First, both orientation and improvisation have essentially to do with the unexpected. In both cases, time constraint plays an important role. Both entail the capacity of seeing the unexpected event opportunities. Both entail the capacity of taking risks, and both entail a learning dimension consisting in the assimilation of routines. This is for the first couple of notions, so let's see the second couple. Collective improvisation is joint action, a plausible definition and for common symptoms. Second thesis, collective improvisation are to be considered as a kind of joint action. And the general possibility of this thesis is that when we decide to improvise together, we decide to do something together. Today we want to paint our house, to take a classical example, but then we decide to have a 2-hour improvising session. Also in this case, we have some common symptoms. The first one is they, collective improvisation and joint action can be, or at least can be planned in a particular place at a specific time. In that case, they involve a specific kind of intention consisting in the intent opposite of performing a particular kind of action. Once planned, they generate commitment among the participants, and once planned, they generate expectations among the participants as well as among people not participating. Now we saw the two couples, and now we want to see the necessity of a joint analysis of these three notions together. First of all, collective improvisation is joint action, a theoretical impasse and a possible solution. Independent from the different solution proposed by the different scholars, the intentional content of the intent of joint action includes some further determinations of it. This point is common to very different accounts of the intentionality involved in joint action, such as those of Tuomela, Gilbert, Pratman, or Searle. The very notion of improvisation, however, entails the idea of an action not planned in advance. I can plan together with some partners that we will improvise, but we cannot plan what we will improvise. The impasse. Apparently, collective improvisation cannot be determined via the intentional content of its intent, which is almost empty. But examples can be brought which falsify the statement. If tomorrow we plan an improvisation session on jazz standards, and for the whole session we improvise on classical themes in a baroque style, the public can legitimately be disappointed. Such disappointment is generated by expectation, which seems to have to do with the intentional content of the intent of the collective improvisation. But we saw that this is not possible. This content cannot determine the improvisation. So a plausible solution to this enigma is that such disappointment can be explained in terms of guidance expectations. We cannot decide what we will improvise, but we can decide in which direction our improvisation performance will be. So people were expecting that the improvisation would be oriented in a particular way determined in advance and to which the musician were committed. Finally, in the last slides, I want to see the theoretical fruitfulness of the joint analysis. First of all, the notion of compass track orientation is a hermeneutical tool for analyzing improvised action, but which can in the second instance be applied to other kinds of joint action. The study of the long distance orientation of animals, I quote here Stegmaier, distinguishes between a compass track orientation and a target orientation. Compass orientation determines the direction or simply the track of migrations, and target orientation determines the target of this track. End of quote. Finally, the improvisational character of philosophical inquiry. Kant uses the metaphor of compass in several works in order to illustrate the nature of philosophical inquiry. If he is right in the usage of this metaphor, then we can plausibly state the philosophical inquiry as something essential in common with the exercise of improvisation. I thank you all for your time and attention.